Tonight we have a closer look at a graphic and violent video war game that is sparking outrage even before it arrives in stores. Instead of featuring a make-believe battle, this game offers a vivid depiction of one of the fiercest battles of the Iraq War, the fight for the city of Fallujah. And many U.S. military families say the game goes too far.
So far, I've offered advice and just to technical aspects of the games and things that make it authentic to history, you know, including rates of fire, being accurate, making sure the M16 isn't a fully automatic weapon, which it is in some games.
But a term we use more often is authenticity. That means that we recreate the essential elements of the experience and we leave out those that are non-essential. We are a video game, and we need to be accessible as such and provide gameplay. So we make some concessions to that.
Marines came back from Fallujah and started telling us about the engagements. Became clear to us very quickly that it would not be possible to actually recreate this battle with any conventional engine. And so we knew at that point that we would have to build a new engine from scratch.
6 days in Fallujah drops the player into the boots of a Marine during Operation Phantom Fury, the most intense urban warfare for U.S. troops in half a century. In the real Battle of Fallujah, more than 4 dozen Americans and over 1,000 insurgents were killed as coalition forces captured the city.
Don't stop, keep moving!
Atomic Games hopes to release 6 days in Fallujah next year. When it's done, it could be among the most historically accurate and controversial war games ever made.
Now, if you are a real gamer, you will remember 6 days in Fallujah and the controversy around this Konami-produced game back in the day. Now, the game surprisingly is coming back, and it's actually being headed by the guy who headed the game back in the day. And recently, people have been sort of memeing it because an article written by Polygon interviewed this guy, and he basically said, "We're not trying to make a political statement about the war." Now, if you actually read the article, it's a bit more nuanced than that. Still has similar problems. So what we're going to look at today is the history of this game, why it was controversial, why it was, you know, canned. We're also going to talk about Orientalism again, because, you know, I'm a political science basic bitch. I've got to reference Edward Said whenever we talk about this stuff. But I feel it's relevant because basically what this game wants to do is show the conflict, show the human side from mainly the US perspective, also some Iraqi civilians. But in doing so and doing it in this US-centric viewpoint and not addressing a lot of the war crimes and controversy, what it does essentially is help whitewash this really brutal conflict. Just like most wars, who did it hurt most? The civilians and the citizens of Fallujah paid a long time after the coalition forces left.
But before we go any further, edgier content on my channel is always demonetized, so if you want to support me monetarily, please check out my Patreon. Thanks so much to everyone who has already done this. At the moment, the benefits are gaining access to the private Discord server, and you'll obviously have your name featured at the end of every video and in the description. I'm working for some other benefits that will come in the future. If you want to join our growing community, please check out the Discord and the subreddit in the description. And if you want to follow me personally, check out at the Kavernacle on Instagram and Twitter. And also u/TommyCahill1995 for my personal Reddit. So with that out of the way, let's get into the video.
If you like my content, please like the video and maybe subscribe. Also, we're slowly chugging along to 25k subs. For every 5k, I get a new chocolate orange. Almost there. Imagine a fifth chocolate orange in the pile. Wouldn't that be so amazing? It would make your life forever. And also, I live stream about 2 times a week. A lot of people say they don't get notifications for it, so if you want to get notified for my live streams and my videos, press the bell. But there's a certain setting you need to go on, so make sure you check your settings while you press that bell. But now let's get into the video. So my own specific background with this stuff, of course, I'm 25. I basically grew up during the war and terror. It was always on the news from a very young age. I remember it being on the news, Afghanistan, Iraq. When I was 18, of course, you had the rise of ISIS in Iraq, so it all came back, even after Obama pulled out the majority of US forces in 2011. But because I'm getting older, I start to remember a lot of people maybe don't remember this stuff as well. Also, in terms of education, my background has covered a lot of Middle Eastern politics and conflicts from undergrad to postgrad. I wrote my master's thesis on the first Gulf War, so I have a pretty good understanding of this stuff and knowledge. But we're going to throw little bits of that in throughout the video, but primarily we're going to focus on the game and I guess the ideology driving this game and why it's problematic, but we're going to throw in some history stuff there as well. So while researching for this game, I came across various interviews for the time. I think this one on GameSpot's channel from 2009 is a good one to get you in the mindset of what these guys were trying to do back in the day. So let's quickly take a look at this video.
Many years, and this work brought us close to many of the Marines who fought in Fallujah. And after these Marines got back from Fallujah, they talked to us about making a video game to tell the world about their experiences there. And so we built an engine in which players can blow holes in any wall, collapse any building. It basically allows you the flexibility to move anywhere within the environment and use the same tactics that the Marines were using.
It's not conventional warfare where you have a force on one side and an opposing force on the other side in a straight line. The enemy's all around. There are no front lines per se, and you have to have your Marines and your team, your squad, facing, you know, 360.
It's important as people understand that 6 days in Fallujah is not about whether the U.S. and its allies should have invaded Iraq. It's a factual recreation of the true stories of the Marines who fought there, and as you know, presented to us by the Marines who were actually there.
So from that interview with one Marine and two of the developers, you can see what they were trying to do here. Now I'm going to put some gameplay on screen, which was pre-alpha. And essentially what this game looked like was sort of like SOCOM, Gears of War, Ghost Recon. And they talked about destructible environments, although I don't think it's that revolutionary since Bad Company was out about this time as well. And Bad Company 2 was going to be released in the same year. And they have very, very destructible environments, but maybe in a military sim style, that's quite interesting. Now, since the Second Battle of Fallujah was such a brutal conflict with very close quarters fighting in between buildings and stuff, I guess they're trying to go for that angle in developing this game. Now, I've showed you that clip. You guys might be aware of the history, but GameSpot did a really good article about 8 years ago just doing a timeline of all this stuff, and it's very, very interesting. Now, in that video, you also saw Peter Tamte. I don't know how you really say that. Let's say Tamte, just to keep consistent in this video. But let's go for the article. 6 days in Fallujah, the untold story. In 2009, Konami announced it would no longer be publishing the Atomic Games developed 6 days in Fallujah. 3 years on, we speak to Atomic president Peter Tamte about the events that inspired the controversial title, the impact of Konami's decision, and the road ahead. So Atomic Games was first approached by the Marine Corps in 2002 with a request to redesign the Close Combat series, a real-time tactical war game modeled after the Avalon Hill-developed board game Advanced Squad Leader and published by Microsoft for specific USMC training purposes. By 2003, Atomic was closely working with the Marine Corps on developing a number of different training systems, so that's interesting to remember with this history of the game. It was during the development of one of these systems, based on Atomic's squad-based military first-person shooter, First to Fight, that the USMC assigned its first dozen or so Marines to help guide Atomic on everything from room-clearing tactics to weapon accuracy. Most of the Marines walking around the Atomic studio during the time had just returned from fighting in Operation Iraqi Freedom, the first military operation against Iraq by the US. The operation began on March 19, 2003 and ended on May 1, 2003, following an announcement made by President Bush declaring an end to combat operations in Iraq. As Marines came and went, the same faces began to pop up again and again until eventually Atomic development staff found themselves working with a core group of about a dozen Marines, most of them from a 3-1 unit, a battalion level infantry and support personnel unit. Despite the fact that the group only met twice a year, friendships formed easily. Again, important to remember this stuff as well. So Atomic president Peter Tamte recalls that he knew the Marines were due to be deployed to Fallujah, but no one at the studio knew anything about the battle until it was all over. He says, "It wasn't until they returned that we found out that more than 40% of the battalion was either killed or wounded in battle." Again, remember all this stuff. Remember this guy's personal connection to these Marines. The first Marine to contact Atomic after the battle was a sergeant who had been medevaced out of the area during the fighting. He wondered whether Tamte and his team would be interested in making a game based on his and other Marines' experience of the conflict. Atomic said yes. Tamte said, "Fortunately, while some had been wounded, all of the Marines we knew returned from Iraq. They told us stories about Fallujah that reminded me of World War II stories I grew up hearing. Stories about 18 to 21 year olds thrown into a perilous situation where they have the opportunity to prove to themselves and the world what kind of humans they are. They have to make fundamental decisions, not just about life and death, but about what they hold as their most important values." when the Marines expressed their interest in recreating their experiences of Fallujah in the form of a video game, Tamte saw a chance to stretch the limits of the medium. After that, the stories started flowing, stories about creeping through darkened warehouses, schools and homes, stories about ambushes and face-to-face combat, stories about Iraqi insurgents taking so much liquid adrenaline before a gunfight that it often took 6 or 7 shots to bring them down. The biggest difference I noticed in the Marines before and after Fallujah was the realization that the enemy was much tougher than we thought. While there were certainly many tough fights during the initial Marine movement in 2003 from Kuwait to Baghdad, the battle for Fallujah was as tough as anything I had heard about from the Vietnam War or World War II. I met with Marines who, after being wounded, would get treatment and beg to return to their unit because they didn't want their closest friends battling this enemy without help. The second battle of Fallujah, or Operation Phantom Fury, labelled as the most heated urban firefight in recent US military history since the 1968 Battle of Hue City in Vietnam, was a joint British and Iraqi offensive in November and December 2004. It was designed to clear the town of Fallujah of the Iraqi insurgency, estimated to be about around 2,000 to 3,000 strong, ahead of the national Iraqi elections scheduled for January 2005. The city of roughly 250,000 inhabitants had become a hiding place for Iraqi insurgents following the first Battle of Fallujah in 2004, which saw the US Marines attack the city following the killing of 4 Blackwater security contractors. Combined US coalition and British casualties following the end of the conflict numbered just over 200 and 1,000 wounded. It was later reported that thousands of Iraqi civilians died during the combined first and second battles of Fallujah, with a further estimated 200,000 people losing their homes in the conflict. The aftermath offered little respite. Reports of anti-US sentiment in Fallujah gave way to renewed fighting between insurgents and US troops in the region, leading to the growing realization that Fallujah had become a cautionary tale rather than a success story for the US military. Then in 2010 came disturbing evidence of a possible link between battlefield residue and a dramatic spike in birth defects, cancer, leukemia, and infant mortality in Fallujah. Don't worry, we're going to get into all that a bit later. Writing for The Guardian in December 2011, former US Marine and Fallujah veteran Ross Caputi spoke of his regret and the role he played in the 2004 conflict, saying, "It's been 7 years and the lies that justified the assaults perpetrate false beliefs about what we did. The US veterans who fought there still do not understand who they fought against or what they were fighting for." GameSpot then spoke to Tamte and asked him if he realized what he was walking into, and he said, "I've spoken with very few people who have a Marine or Iraqi's understanding of the events, but wouldn't it be better for everyone if we gain the understanding while these events are unfolding rather than waiting until it doesn't matter anymore?" He also said that the goal of the game has always been to use the experiences, actions, and consequences of Marines fighting in the Fallujah conflict to give players a deeper understanding of the violent events that have helped shape recent history, while simultaneously changing expectations of what a video game can be. But the game was never going to be released, so I'm going to play you quickly a clip of the outrage on the news of people whose, you know, sons died in the battle.
When I heard about it, it was very upsetting.
Karen Meredith, whose son Ken was killed in Iraq, joined a chorus of military families in fervent opposition. They fear the game will trivialize the sacrifice of their loved ones.
I have this image of a bunch of guys sitting around laughing because they got killed or they didn't get killed, or let's start over because we can. My son didn't have that choice.
So you see in that, and then the GameSpot article goes on to say, 3 weeks later, Konami cancelled its publishing deal with Atomic. Tamte said the decision came as a shock to them, which up to that point they'd received nothing but support from the publisher, saying, "There were literally no disagreements between Atomic and Konami's American team. We all saw 6 days in Fallujah the same way. It was the board of directors for Konami's parent company, Japan, who got freaked out about the controversy." And he says that Konami didn't want its brand associated with this controversy. And Tamte goes on to say, "I think if they had waited longer to let our story be heard, they would have benefited from the outpouring of support we received for 6 days in Fallujah. As people began to understand more about what it really was, contemplate new ideas about what a video game could be, and this takes time. Unfortunately, Konami's board of directors didn't seem to understand." So that is a short explanation of what this game was, how it was developed, and the outrage that led to its cancellation by Konami at the end of the day. Of course, because I'm making this video, it has reared its head again, and Tamte, whatever his name is, has given interviews about this game. Now let's just review what we've gone through already. this company were making basically training games for the US military. That we know already. They were deep in bed with the US military, knew a lot of Marines who fought in Iraq. They knew a lot of Marines who also fought in Fallujah. And I'm highlighting all of this to say that regardless of what this guy's politics are, when you have this personal experience of these people who fought in this conflict, your perspective of this conflict is obviously going to be influenced by these guys. Now, when you hear their stories and you hear their lives and you become friends with them, you're obviously going to become more sympathetic to their worldview, their view of the conflict, and their view of what was necessary in this battle. So it goes without saying, this guy being heavily involved in the game coming out still makes me extremely skeptical of how nuanced this game is going to be. If these people that you're friends with who all fought in the war are giving you, you know, all your information, even if like some of them said they regret fighting there, they didn't know what they were fighting for, because them and their friends often did things like war crimes, killed civilians, used uranium-coated rounds on civilians, which they weren't supposed to do, essentially made Fallujah a free fire zone, and we're going to get into more into the war crimes a bit later, while telling you that the insurgents were all taking loads of drugs, which made them essentially unstoppable, I don't think you're going to take the side of the Iraqi civilians who suffered the most. Also, I don't think there's going to be too much nuance, because in the old game, they were going to focus on Al-Qaeda. Now, Al-Qaeda, of course, played a very prominent role in the insurgency, but they weren't the only group involved. You, of course, had the ex-military of Saddam Hussein, all kicked out of the military upon, you know, the conquest of Iraq. So you have loads of military-trained men not having any means to income. But these guys weren't Islamic extremists, because Al-Qaeda hated Saddam Hussein, Bin Laden hated Saddam Hussein. Baathist Arab socialists and Islamic extremists weren't best friends, but they could often unite around the cause of getting rid of Westerners. Then you even had local insurgencies who just wanted the US out. You had Shia militias as well, backed by countries like Iran. You had all these different groups fighting them. Of course, that is probably too nuanced for these guys who are making a game when they used to be in bed with the US military. But we're going to get into it, but you don't play as the insurgency in this game. But they are letting you play as an Iraqi civilian. But I doubt we're going to see any reason why this insurgency existed in the first place, and that it was actually pretty diverse, rather than what I expect is they're just going to paint them as Al-Qaeda extremists all taking adrenaline. So when you're using white phosphorus or uranium-coated rounds on them, it seems quite justifiable. So last week, this guy, Tamte, gave multiple interviews, and the Polygon one was probably the most famous. I don't really want to use that one. I want to use this one instead, gameindustry.biz, and it's written by James Batchelor, so I thought it was interesting. So he also acknowledges that reasonable people can argue that the war in Iraq should never have happened, so that's good to hear at least. But he's most interested in the November 2004 battle, where the majority of US forces sent into Fallujah were killed or wounded. He said the stories he heard from soldiers who survived are one of remarkable courage and sacrifice, and he felt compelled to tell their stories. Again, this guy is coming into it with the view of the Americans, even if they were misguided, even if the war was wrong, these guys being heroic, simply not true, especially as we're going to get into the war crime stuff later. So despite the game refusing to address the question of whether the soldiers should have been there in the first place, Tamte says it's important to provide players with context, saying, "We can't tell the story without telling the rest of it. We have to give the players the context for why they're in the city and why this battle exists. There were very specific things that led up to the battle for Fallujah. Players need that context to understand why they're in the city fighting those Al-Qaeda people. We're going to provide that context, but without making a political statement or without in any way disparaging the service of those who actually fought." Now, that already tells me a lot of what I need to know about this game. If you're not going to disparage the service of people who fought in the war, then I don't think it's worth telling. Some of the best Vietnam War movies show the soldiers being awful. I recently watched Casualties of War with Michael J. Fox and Sean Penn and John C. Reilly, centering around the abuse and killing of a Vietnamese girl. There's other films like Platoon where you see war crimes against civilians. Apocalypse Now is essentially about the craziness of this war, where you do also see war crimes and stuff. If the US servicemen are going to be put on some pedestal where they did actually commit war crimes, but you're never going to show us that or hint at it, then you are whitewashing the history of this conflict. So he addresses the war crime thing. So the article says, "Like the cause of the war itself, another bit of context that won't appear in the game is the use of white phosphorus by the US forces long criticised as a war crime, Tamte saying, "So players cannot use white phosphorus. We're not asking players to commit atrocities in the game. Are we effectively sanitising events by not doing that? I don't think we need to portray the atrocities in order for people to understand the human cost. We can do that without the atrocities." No, you can't. I think you've got to show them, because otherwise you are sanitising the war. War is ugly. War is, you know, dirty. These things happen. The best war movies show this sort of thing. You know, human nature, how awful people are in these scenarios, what they will do when they have power over, like, civilians, like in Vietnam, like in Iraq. By not showing this stuff, you are omitting it, and we turn it back to the, you know, the Orientalism stuff, that the power and knowledge stuff. So you're essentially telling us the story of this battle, a guy who is in bed with the US Marine Corps, while Iraqi civilians don't have a platform to show their side of it. Iraqis who were in Fallujah at the time don't have a massive budget to make a video game about how they experienced this conflict and what the US soldiers did to them. So you are sanitizing the conflict, and there's not nuance there, and it's going to make the US soldiers appear heroic, and then this will help rehabilitate the war, just like Ronald Reagan did with the Vietnam War and the neocons back in the 1980s. Doing stuff like this makes it seem like a noble cause, or at the very least, makes the soldiers involved seem heroic and noble, even though plenty of them killed civilians and did war crimes. But the guy also keeps referring that it's not a political statement in the game, but you do get to play as an Iraqi civilian, so he's keen to emphasise the scenes where you play as a civilian caught in the conflict trying to escort his family to safety. Like the main missions, these sections have been informed by interviews of civilians who survived the battle, but he didn't want to make this the whole game, so he said, "Very few people are curious what it's like to be an Iraqi civilian, okay. Nobody's going to play that game. Maybe they would, but people are curious what it's like to be in combat. It's the same reason people play survival horror games, being in a situation that is beyond what we have in our normal lives. Ultimately, the reason why people are going to play this game is because they want a more realistic combat experience. That, above all else, is the experience we must deliver." So I'm sure a lot of people would actually want to play the game where you play as an Iraqi civilian caught up in this brutal conflict, rather than another military shooter where all brown people are bad and white Americans are heroes, even if the cause they're fighting for is completely wrong and even if there's plenty of war crimes involved. I would rather play that game. It's way more interesting to me. And I would say, as this, you know, rich developer, that would be a better use of your time. And you can still include all the US testimony, the Marines and stuff. You don't have to completely demonize the soldiers there, even if you did it from an Iraqi civilian's point of view. But again, this tells you everything you need to know. No war crimes, not much playing as an Iraqi civilian, just a little bit so people don't kick up a fuss. But I'm sure the Iraqi civilian sections are going to be very nuanced. I'm sure these Iraqi civilians might even support the insurgency. No way. The Americans are just going to be depicted as the saviors for these Iraqi civilians. Let's keep it real. So addressing his work with the US military before, the company has stated that the US government has not funded the game. And he says, "It's true that 15 years ago I built training systems, and I'm proud of that work that we did building those, but I haven't had any contact with that part of the business for at least 11 years now." So that is where the game is currently at, and it's going to be released in the near future. I'm excited to check it out just to see how, like, misguided and awful it is. But now let's talk about the war crimes that he thinks are okay to admit. Even though the civilians of Fallujah have been suffering with the effects of these battles for over a decade after the conflict. So here's a big one. So US fired depleted uraniums at civilian areas in 2003 Iraq War, report finds. US forces fired these rounds at civilian areas and troops in Iraq in breach of official advice meant to prevent unnecessary suffering in conflict, a report has found. Coordinates revealing where US jets and tanks fired nearly 10,000 depleted uranium rounds in Iraq during the war in 2003 have been obtained by the Dutch peace group PAX. This is the first time that any USDU firing coordinates have been released. According to the PAX report, which is due to be published this week, the data shows that many of the rounds were fired in near or populated areas of Iraq. At least 1,500 rounds were also aimed at troops, the group says. This conflicts with legal advice from the US Air Force in 1975, suggesting that depleted uranium weapons should only be used against hard targets like tanks and armored vehicles. This advice, designed to comply with international law by minimizing deaths and injuries to urban populations and troops, was largely ignored by US forces, and this was ignored by US forces in Fallujah, who did use uranium rounds to punch through buildings, because what this developer is talking about is how, you know, close combat within this city And yeah, they use uranium rounds to make it easier to penetrate the buildings. And it is heavily speculated, white phosphorus, uranium rounds, everything like that has led to birth defects, cancer, and everything like that being far more prominent in Fallujah after the battles there. So another Guardian article says, for years, medical doctors in Iraq have reported a high level of birth defects. Other peer-reviewed studies have documented a dramatic increase in infant mortality, cancer, and leukemia in the aftermath of the US military bombardment. In Fallujah, doctors are witnessing massive, unprecedented numbers of heart defects, an increase in the number of nervous system defects. Analysis of pre-2003 data compared to now showed that the rate of congenital heart defects was 95 per 1,000 births, 13 times that the rate found in Europe. So another article by The Independent says, toxic legacy of US assault on Fallujah worse than Hiroshima. Dramatic increases in infant mortality, cancer and leukemia in the Iraqi city of Fallujah, which was bombarded by the US Marines in 2004, exceed those reported by survivors of the atomic bombs that were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 1945, according to a new study. Iraqi doctors in Fallujah have complained since 2005 of being overwhelmed by the number of babies with serious birth defects, ranging from a girl born with two heads to paralysis of lower limbs. They said they're also seeing far more cancers than they did before the Battle of Fallujah between the US troops and the insurgents. In the assault, US commanders largely treated Fallujah as a free fire zone to try and reduce casualties among their own troops. British officers were appalled by the lack of concern for civilian casualties. So wouldn't you think that stuff is kind of worth mentioning about how this conflict was so destructive that the civilians left behind are facing so much awful stuff? It's the exact same stuff with Vietnam. All the stuff the Americans did there, completely whitewashed. And it is going to be in this video game as well, where the war crimes that have really hurt these Iraqi people are going to be totally ignored by this new game, and the heroism of the American forces is going to be elevated. Adding to the Orientalist depictions of this war and general US war crimes in military engagements, which constantly get sanitized, despite being some of the most awful stuff you ever read about. Now, despite this conflict being over a decade and a half old, it still has an effect today. Now, General James Mattis was, of course, put in the Trump administration. His appointment, I think it was like 98-1 in the Senate, confirmed. Now, let's read about what this guy did. This guy did all this stuff in Fallujah and Iraq, and then he gets to serve in the government. No consequences. If this guy was an Iranian general, the US would be out to get him right now. Retired General James Mattis earned his nickname Mad Dog for leading US Marines into battle in Fallujah, Iraq in 2004. In the assault, members of the Marine Corps under Mattis' command shot at ambulances and aid workers. They cordoned off the city, prevented civilians from escaping. They posed for trophy photos of the people they killed. Each of these offences has put other military commanders and members of the rank and file in front of international war crimes tribunals. The doctrine that landed them there dates back to World War II, when an American military tribunal held Japanese General Tomoyuki Yamashita accountable for war crimes in the Philippines. His execution was later upheld by the US Supreme Court. Before Mattis' command in Iraq ended, he was involved in another controversial incident. On May 19th, less than 3 weeks after his forces pulled back from Fallujah, Mattis personally authorized an attack on a wedding party near the Syrian border. The Iraqi government said the strike left 42 civilians dead, including at least 13 children. The killings came soon after the carnage of Fallujah, but Mattis stood by his actions, arguing the dead were insurgents, saying, "How many people go to the middle of the desert to hold a wedding 80 miles from the nearest civilization? There were more than 24 military-aged males, let's not be naive." In the years since, Mattis, called a warrior monk by his supporters, repeatedly has protected American service members who killed civilians, using his status as a division commander to wipe away criminal charges against Marines accused of massacring 24 Iraqi civilians in 2005, and granted clemency to some of those convicted in connection with the 2006 murder of a 52-year-old disabled Iraqi who was taken outside his home and shot in the face 4 times. Again, this guy became one of the most powerful men in the military after being confirmed to the Trump administration. And that is why it's so important when you're making media discussing things that are controversial, like the Iraq War, that you have to depict it as it was and not sanitize it and not make it from the perspective of the US Marine Corps, not have the guy who used to make training software for the Marine Corps, who's personally friends with many Marines who fought in that conflict, because what you're going to get, even if you're trying your hardest to maybe show other sides of the conflict, but maybe showing Iraqi civilians and what happened to them in the war, even if you're doing that, it's still going to be completely Western-centric, American-centric, and slanted, and you're not going to want to show the war crimes because it's going to personally offend your buddies and all the people you made this game with and all the people you've been making this game with for, you know, over a decade now. So that is the problem. And even the best Vietnam War movies, you know, Oliver Stone's movies, they have problems of Orientalism in that the Vietnamese are never actually showed as proper characters. They're caricatures. They're people who are either, you know, complicit in the killing of US troops, or they're just civilians to be killed, essentially, but there's no character given to them. Their side is not told. And yes, I would rather play the game where you play as an Iraqi civilian in Fallujah rather than running around Fallujah with the US Marines committing war crimes, but no, they're not actually war crimes because I'm not going to include them. You're just going to be shooting Al-Qaeda, because we have to frame this in a really, really obvious way where US Marine Corps good, Al-Qaeda are the only villains, therefore they are bad. You all know Al-Qaeda are bad. And also, I just thought of this, it also helps further the narrative about Iraq essentially being justified because, well, you're fighting Al-Qaeda now, the people who attacked the US on 9/11. So even though the conflict was bad and the justification for the invasion was wrong based on a lie, well, at least you're fighting the guys who attacked the US now. All this stuff helps contribute to the myths about these wars, and it ensures people like General Mattis and others who are involved in this stuff will never ever be held accountable. How many war crimes does the US have to commit in Vietnam, in Iraq, Afghanistan, and how many times are they never ever going to be held accountable? And this is why stuff like this makes me sick, because you're just helping with their propaganda. And it is just so funny, the guy making this game used to make training stuff for the US Marine Corps. Again, it's a total joke, but I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you enjoyed the history of the game, and hope you enjoyed why I have such a problem with it being made. Let me know what you guys think in the comments. I had to be quite brief a lot of the history, but I have made videos on this stuff before, which you can go and check out. If you want to find me on social media, at the Kavernacle, Twitter and Instagram, come join our communities on Discord and Reddit. Also, check out my Patreon. Stuff like this is demonetized, so I appreciate any support. And if you made it this far, thank you for watching.